was the metric of flat space, the units, the unit three-sphere, the unit Euclidean area space. Okay? Or ds squared is equal to minus a squared, plus a squared into minus d theta squared plus ds three squared. Now these two a's are the same a. Because the coefficient of what multiplies ds three squared is geometric significance, sine of the three squared. Okay? So it's the same a. It's just that you're using, that there's a coordinate change going between them, and let's write down this coordinate change because we need it in this picture. Clearly, d eta by d t in A, d eta by d t is, right? No. Okay. Now, I'm going to be a little more careful than last class. I'm sometimes going to use this coordinate system. And sometimes the other one. Some things are easier and one things are easier. Okay? So, I'm going to do the following. Lagrangians only ever use, the calculations only ever use this coordinate system. And so I'm going to follow the notation that prime is equal to d by d. Okay? In agreement with lambda relations, while the dot will be d by d. Okay? So from this fact, we find that a prime or a dot is equal to 1 by a and alpha, not for any alpha, alpha prime. Right? Because dot is d by dt, which is d eta by dt times d by d eta. By the chain. Okay, this will be true for everyone. It will be useful when we move between the different boxes. Actually, I think all the lights on.
Lights
on.
On.
The top is. Excellent. Okay, so we started last class trying to derive the equations of motion for A and epsilon, the energy density in the fluid stress tensor that we talked about a lot last class. Okay, so let's continue with this with our attempt. If you remember, we had an expression for R 0, 0, which was equal to 3 by 8 to 4. Into a prime squared minus a eta. And this expression is correct whether the base space is S3, flat space, or Euclidean space. Okay? But, and then we also had an expression for rij, which was equal to delta ij times something. Now, the something was. It's equal to delta ij times. There was a minus 1 by a to the 4. Rij is equal to minus 1 by a to the 4 delta ij. And then times, for the sphere we had 2a squared plus a prime squared plus a double prime. Now, if you remember, these terms came from the intrinsic curvature of the sphere itself. This would have been the three-dimensional Rij of the spatial metric of the sphere. We derived that. Whereas these terms came about again because of the zero case, because gamma is involving zero. Okay? Now, clearly, if we were dealing with a flat space guy, this would be zero. This would be replaced by zero. And if we were dealing with a negatively curved guy, this would be replaced by minus 1. By minus 2 squared. Okay? And it turns out that these terms are unaffected by the length, because it comes from. But it turns out that those terms are unaffected. Okay? So if we are doing this in more generality, we're keeping track of, or we're trying to do all cases at once. you just put a 2k a square here, where k is plus 1 for the sphere, 0 for the flat space, and minus 1 for Euclidean empty space. Okay? Once we've done that, these equations are, everything we do from now on, will be correct for all three cases. Because the universe is the only place, the only place in which the Ricci tensor knows about whether you, the difference between the sphere, flat space, and this Euclidean empty space. Okay. Now that you've got this, the next thing we're going to do is to compute the Ricci scale. The Ricci scale of R, which is R00 plus RII. So let's compute that. So that is equal to 3 by a to the 4 into a prime square minus a double prime. That's from R00. Now from here we get a factor of 3, retracing all the spatials. So that's that 3 there. Everything is minus, that's the a to the 4, and then there's minus 2k a square minus a prime square minus a. Okay? This cancels this. So we get 3 by a to the 4 into, actually 6 by a to the 4, and then the minus sign, a double prime, plus k a square. Okay, so this is the formula for the Ricci scale. Okay, now that we've got these things in hand, what we need to do, we're going to first check. Good. Okay, now we need to derive the Einstein equations. Okay, there are effectively two inequivalent Einstein equations. One of the Einstein equations is the 0-0 Einstein equation, and the other one is either the 1-1 or the 2-2 or the 3-3, they're all the same because everything's proportional to delta i. So, we can conveniently look at these two different Einstein equations by first looking at the equation that you get from 0-0 and second looking at just at the trace of Einstein's equations. That'll be some linear combination of 0-0 and I. Okay? So, let me write down the trace equation first. So, Einstein's equation is R minus R by 2 R mu nu minus R by 2 G mu nu is equal to 8 by T mu nu. Take the trace of this, we find minus R is equal to 8 by K. You get minus R because you've got R here, and then you get minus 4 R by 2, because the trace of G is 4, so you get minus R. Okay. And let's also remember that the stress tensor in the form T mu nu is equal to epsilon plus P U mu minus P G mu nu. So, in particular, we find that T, the trace of this guy, you get plus 1 from here, minus 4 from here, so is equal to epsilon minus. Sounds excellent. Okay. raising an index of the complexities. Okay? Let's immediately write down Einstein's equation that came from here. This equation is minus R is equal to 8 pi k times t. So we get minus 6 by a to the 4 a double prime plus k a squared. But there's a minus here, so that becomes plus, is equal to 8 pi k times 10 t, and t was epsilon minus 10. Okay? So this is one of the equations of the function. Now we want the second equation. The second equation is obtained from the R0 zero component. Okay? So let's keep this stuff on the board. Okay, I'll give you a minute to look at and copy down whatever you want. I'm going to clear this and all of this. Because unfortunately we need stuff on the board to make this. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. We also need an R0. I'll ask somebody to read it. Okay. Now, the second equation we want is the 0-0 component of Einstein's equations. So let's look at that equation with R0 minus half delta 0-0, so that's 1 times R is equal to the time the T0-0 components 8 pi k times epsilon. You see that this just becomes epsilon? Because we are looking at fluid flows in which u mu is 1 0 0. Okay? Yeah, we're looking at a fluid that's stationary in this coordinate system to maintain the isometric, the symmetries. Okay? So the 0 0 component of the stress tensor, whether raised or lowered, it makes no difference. Sorry. Now I'm working in I was thinking I was working in this coordinate system. There raising and lowering makes no difference. So let me be a little quick. Okay. So R0 is equal to 8 pi k T0. Now let's compute this. So we had T0. First, let's remind ourselves what U0 is. You see, U0 squared, A squared is equal to 1. From the fact that U is a normalized vortex. And using the fact that G0 is A squared. Is this clear? So our vector u mu is equal to u 0, 0, 0, 0, where u 0 squared, a squared is 1. So u 0 is equal to, u 0 with an upper is equal to, or is equal to 1. What about u 0 with a lower? Somebody? Correct. U 0 with a lower is equal to a. In many ways of seeing this, one of the simplest is, you take U0 with an upper, which is 1 by A, and lower it with a factor of symmetry, which gives you A squared. So A squared with 1 by A, so A. Now, T0 is equal to U0 epsilon plus P minus P in the delta 0. Right? So just raised one index. But U0 is 1. P cancels to get it. So, yeah, just two index. So it was correct what I did. It was correct because it was lower. Couldn't correct that. the glowers. Okay? Excellent. So now let's, somebody please read out R0.
Is it 1/8 to 4, I remember?
Three by eight to four.
A prime square.
Prime
square.
Minus
A double.
Okay, correct. Minus R for what?
I wrote down R. I'm sorry.
Somebody please read out R.
Yes, sir.
It was minus or plus? R inside was minus six. We had make it plus. Then we have we want R by two, so I'll make the 6 3 by 8 to the 4 into
A.
So that's again?
A
double prime plus
A square.
Plus K. Excellent. Okay, now you see something else next happens. The A double prime term exists. Okay, so we get 3. This is equal to A by K epsilon. Okay, so we have 3 by 8 to the 4 of A prime squared plus A plus K A squared is equal to 8 by K. Okay? This is the second basic equation. So we have done. 3 by 8 to the 4 A prime squared plus K A squared is equal to 8 by 8. Okay. Now before we proceed actually, let me well the 2-3 things I want to do. The first of these is to obtain the equations. Well, actually, this is not the basis in which the equations are normally obtained. The basis in which they're normally obtained is this equation as it is, but then subtracting twice of this equation from this equation. Okay? So, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to obtain a new equation by taking this minus 2 times this. Okay? To make the combination here, epsilon plus 10. Not epsilon plus 10. So, let me do that carefully. So, I want this minus 2 times this. So, what will I get? Because of the 2, everything becomes 6. So, we get 6 by 8 to the 4. And now I have A double prime plus K A squared minus K A squared minus A prime. Okay? Sorry. So minus A prime squared is equal to minus 8 by K. Okay, so instead of regarding this and this as the fundamental equations, I'm going to regard this and this. As you will see, actually, this equation is a simpler way to look at it. Okay, so I'm going to clear this and write this in space. Everyone happy? All I need to do is to employ the simple chain rule. every time this index in alpha prime, I'll replace it by A times alpha dot. Okay? So let me do that.
Epsilon plus.
Okay?
Good.
So now we've gotten to both the basic equations of cosmology. And we're about to start studying them. Okay? Except for one more little thing. Okay. You see, you might have wondered here that there's something odd. You see, firstly, what are the variables? Variables can be thought of as epsilon. We know epsilon giving pressure. And E.
But two variables, we've got two equations.
So we're in business. We might have thought that, look, it's a bit odd that we didn't have to use the matter equations. We just use Einstein's equations. And we got enough equations to solve for everything, including the matter. Why is that? What?
We assumed it to be fluid.
Good. So why is it true that we didn't have to use, why didn't we have to use the fluid equations? That's the equation of state. That's, you know, some statement of what kind of matter is. There's also the equation of motion, which is the conservation of the stress. Why didn't we have to use that? Because that's automatic. The stress tensor on the right-hand side of Einstein's equations must be conserved. It's a consequence of Einstein's equations. So I'd like to see that. I'd like to see that more explicitly.
So I mean, what if I had motion law equations?
What?
In addition to the conservation of stress energy tensor, and some other equations of motion.
Then you would have to impose this. How then there would be new variables in the fluid. The whole fluid would not be captured by just by epsilon. That would, let's say, be a charge density. Suppose you have electromagnetic charges. And then you would have to impose the equation del mu g mu. As a second equation. That would not be enforced by Einstein's equation. Einstein's equation just imposed the form energy conservation.
So in this case, the conservation equations are imposed by the form of T mu nu?
No. T mu nu was, the form of T mu nu does not mean that it's conserved. It's imposed by the fact that you put it on the right hand side of Einstein's equation.
So in some sense, you're getting some part of dynamics from substituting in Einstein.
Yes. By putting it on the right hand side of Einstein's equation. Because Einstein's equations are inconsistent unless the stress tensor is considered. Okay, now I'm going to see this a little more directly. So I'm going to just write out the equation of conservation of the stress tensor. Okay, and try to see if I can show that that follows. I'll show you what I do. Okay, so what is the equation of the conservation of the stress tensor? Where's the in your first problem, hey, and I really promise I'm sending you your second problem set. This will be the second and probably the last. Maybe one more. Maybe we'll have one last problem set as an example. We need to have some sort of evaluation. That'll be very. We won't have a written exam. Maybe just this problem set. Which you have 2 or 3 minutes. Okay. Let's take home. Okay. Fine. Yeah. The conservation of the stress tensor. So, now, let's remember what the equation of the conservation of the stress tensor was. We started our discussion of the energy momentum pseudo tensor. And the equation was, when you work it out, you know, what is gradient of symmetric density. So it's 1 by square root of minus g del mu square root of minus g t mu. And then there's this additional term, right? The term that made all the energy momentum difficult to define. G alpha beta del by del x mu times d alpha. Okay, now let's work this out for the particular case at hand. Okay, so in our, I'm going to work it out, let's say, in this coordinate system. It's a bit easier. Okay, so now in this coordinate system, t 0, 0 is equal to epsilon, as we've seen. And Pij is equal to P. Okay? Translate that. Everything is easy. Okay? So now let's work this out. We got epsilon and P, both of which depend only on P. So the whole stress test is a function only of T. So the only derivative, also the metric is a function only of T. So the only derivative that's not zero is the T derivative. Okay? So in this term, mu has to be T. Therefore, mu has to be T. Therefore, mu has to be T. So this term is 1 by A cube, that's square root G, times dP, d by dt, of A cube epsilon.
So this particular place, you say that temperature must be constant for, because it's metric space.
Yes. Constant space. Okay. Minus half. Once again, the only non-zero derivative is the t derivative. But G00 is independent of time. So it's only Gij when this matters. Okay. So that's d by dt of Gij times Dij. So this is 1 by A cube d by dt of A cube epsilon. Minus half d by dt of Gij is A square times P by A square because of the raising. Tij with 1 up, 1 down is P. You raise with 1 more, you get. And the only thing we have to worry about is having plus sign. So, Gij had a negative P and negative A square. Sorry. Gij had a negative A square, and Pij also has a negative. Pij with 1 up 1 down is positive, P's Ij with 1. So it's in the sign.
We have three such terms.
Ah, very good, very good, very good, very good. Very good. We have three such terms, so we get extra factor. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, now this we can make d by a d by b, so cancelling the 2 is a square. Okay, now let's look at this. Suppose we let the d by dt act on a cube. We get exactly the same term as this, except that we have p instead of epsilon, and epsilon instead of p. Okay. So this is equal to dA by dt actually the sign epsilon we've got it. Okay, let me see what we've got is epsilon minus p. I have to feel it's epsilon plus p. Okay. One by A, 3 by A, plus A, D epsilon by D. Let me just check what I have in my notes. play as well as
epsilon plus p, so that would join vortex.
D epsilon by dt into A squared plus 8 pi k epsilon into d A squared by dt. Okay, so that becomes 16 pi k into A d into A d dot. And here I use this to relate this to so this is equal to, well, let me keep the 8 pi k. This is equal to 8 pi k into, this was 2a, 2 epsilon a dot. And here I have this guy is equal to minus 3 pi a. So that's, this makes this a dot. Into epsilon plus k. Okay? So yeah, so the a dot comes out, which he said. 8 pi k a dot into 2 epsilon minus 3 epsilon, so it's minus epsilon plus minus epsilon minus 3. Put a minus out, epsilon. So exactly. Okay. So that tells you that we can forget about the space, you know, the second Einstein equation. Just use the equation that came from the conservation of energy momentum plus this equation, which was the 0-0 Einstein equation. Okay? And that gives you all the information that you want. Because the space part of the Einstein equation is obtained, can be derived from these two. Okay? So, now we can adopt these two as our fundamental equations of conservation. Okay. Now, with these equations in hand, how do we go around, go about solving the problem? Okay, it's very straightforward. This equation looks like it has time derivatives, but that's actually a phase, so you can cancel the dt's in that sense. This is a differential equation that allows you to determine A in terms of epsilon. So you can write this equation as 3 by A integral d A by A, so that's d log A. So that's 3 by, that's 3 log A is equal to minus integral d epsilon divided by epsilon plus d.
So we need to know d as function.
That's an equation of state. You need to know the equation of state. Once you have that equation of state, you can do the integral on the right hand side. And that gives you A as a function of epsilon, and epsilon as a function of A. Okay? Once we have this in hand, and then we take the second equation, that's this, and solve it as follows. We find what dA by, this is now like an equation in classical mechanics, we keep the kinetic term. In terms of a potential, so you use the usual tricks, or the usual tricks, you write this as, you first solve for A dot, so A dot is equal to 8 pi k A squared epsilon by 3. Now we're using k for 2. This is 0, 1, minus 1. Let's make this g. I'm replacing this by Newton's constant. 8 pi g by 3 epsilon squared, and then minus k squared. Okay?
Sir, in the absence of minus, the equation of state,
the RHS integral goes up, right?
Ha, very good. This is for the cosmological constant, right?
Yeah.
Yes. So what does that tell you? That for the, it, then we should just look at the equation here. Because epsilon, take the dA down here. This tells us that because epsilon plus p is 0, dA by d, d epsilon by dA is 0. Which means epsilon doesn't change. Which we know. Epsilon is a basic property of the vacuum. It doesn't change because of evolution. Right? So, in that particular case, you don't have to go through all of this. You just replace epsilon by the constant value, namely lambda. And p by its, let's say, constant value, minus lambda. Okay? Excellent. Okay, and so this can now be integrated by dA by square root of 8 pi g a square epsilon by 3 minus k integral is equal to t plus t. I should have written the answer in a slightly more systematic way. Okay, so let me first do the listing results. Let me write the equation of conservation of stress tensor. Yeah, so that's 3dA. Well, let me write this as 3 by A yeah, epsilon plus B. Is equal to minus d epsilon. This was energy momentum conservation equation. Okay, and then the solution was 3 log A is equal to minus d epsilon by epsilon plus p, and dA by 8 by g by 3 a squared epsilon minus k is equal to d plus c. Okay, this is what the solution was. In terms of the time period, this equation doesn't refer to either time or eta, so it must be the same. Just relationship, a which is the same, and epsilon and p which is the same, and so this holds true. This is an absolute relation. Just tells you what a is in terms of epsilon. This thing, reference to what coordinate system you're using. I mean, what level is it? T. But this, of course, changes depending on whether we're using A or eta, because this will change. And let's see how that goes. Here we would have used this equation, A dot squared plus K A squared by e to the 4. Okay? So, we would have had an extra e to the 4 here and an extra A squared. So, effectively, the A squared, this cancel, of course, but effectively, there is an extra A squared in the denominator of the expression for A prime. Right? So, A prime would have had an extra A squared here. Would have had an extra A here. A prime squared would have had an A. So, we would have dA by A square root 8 pi g A squared epsilon by 3 minus k is equal to 2 minus. Okay? And this completes our
formal listing of the equations of cosmic motion. Okay. In the next few minutes, now we're going to try to understand physically what this means. But any questions or comments about this? Okay. About the behavior of these equations without actually solving them, just by looking at them. As follows. Let's first look at this equation. Let me work in the dot, the D. Okay, so let's look at the equation. 6A double dot by A. Minus 8 pi k epsilon plus. Okay.
So for all three k's, we'll get some three solutions.
We'll get what solutions?
For all different three k's we have.
Yeah, the three k's are different discrete choices.
For all distribution of k, we can get all three.
All distribution
are dependent on k.
What's it again?
Value of k.
Is yeah independent choice from what the equation of state is.
For a given k,
we'll be able to get for a given k with a particular equation of state, you have a particular cosmology. K is a discrete choice chosen once and for all. And then, alright, so each of them, but we'll be seeing that these three different values of k have rather different kinds of physics. So, in order to try to get a feel for this, we're going to start. well, let's look at this equation. The first thing that we see from here is that as long as epsilon plus 3p, epsilon is an energy density. So it's reasonable that it's positive. If the matter in question has positive pressure as well, which is true of many kinds of equations of state, but not the cosmological constant with one sign does not have pressure, does not have positive pressure. But if the matter in a question has positive pressure as well, then the right hand side is positive. Okay?
Because every other matter is positive.
What?
Because every other matter
no.
Otherwise
no, rubber band is negative pressure. Okay.
It massively collapses at right.
That collapses, you know, part of the evolution of the universe. you know, the universe is not staying still, partly because things are pressure.
But once they reach equilibrium, I presume that I'm positive.
But the universe is never equilibrium. Okay? right, yes, you're right. But
negative pressures have to do with collapses.
Negative pressures are to do with the fact that it wants to. Right? Just like positive pressures. But just like positive pressures, you can keep something in negative pressure by holding its ends. It's like a positive pressure is balanced by putting more on the string. It wants to expand, but it can't because of the walls. Similarly, negative pressure can be held by putting appropriate. What?
Real mass is actually a bit of force.
What do you mean?
Negative pressure aren't one till a certain point. Can we sort of map that?
Yeah. You know, the matter that we're going to consider, we'll have both. You know, there'll be a cosmological constant on one side, which has negative pressure. Yeah. But suppose, for a moment, we're dealing with the right-hand side, where epsilon plus 3p is positive. Okay. So then this acceleration is negative. This is the intuitive thing you expect from gravity.
Here we take
what?
If k we take to the positive.
K, again, this k is Newton's question. Which is root to positive. Okay? This is intuitively what you expect from that. You know, it's like the universe is, well, expanding, but in a decelerating way. Okay? it's expanding, but in a decent rate. Now suppose this is the case. What must the curve for A versus T look like? A versus T, because it's decelerating, must look something like this. A is finite today, this equation. Okay? And because the curve looks like this, then at some finite time in the past, A must be equal to zero. We'll take that time, wherever it is, to be the origin. We'll set our origin to be at that time, where A was. Okay? So, we get rid of these constants in the equations by making this choice that A is equal to zero when T was zero. Okay? Now, let's look at the next thing. Let's look at this energy conservation equation.
Okay, there was a form of the equation that had, was more useful for me.
It was d,
what was it?
D a cube epsilon by dt.
The original form of the equation somebody had here.
D a cube epsilon by dt was equal to minus p.
Okay, somebody who's got this equation tell me. Look, the first equation we wrote down.
The energy conservation equation, when we first wrote it up, this was the energy part, what was it? The other part? Minus P A dot, something else. This upper number, right? Did I get the sign right? Minus 3t.
My value cubed.
Something. Something.
Yeah.
Adjust this? Okay. The point I want to make is in the sign. So, you want to hold the back. You see, suppose the left right hand side was zero. Suppose the right hand side was zero. Okay? Then this would tell us that epsilon went like 1 over 8. So epsilon is decaying as A increases, like 1 over 8. Now, if the pressure is positive, we know A dot is positive. Okay? If the pressure is positive, so that's our second assumption. Just to get a feeling, we're making various assumptions just to get a feeling for how these equations are. If the pressure is positive, then the right hand side is negative. Which means that epsilon has to decrease faster than 1 by 8. Okay? So epsilon, as A increases, epsilon decreases if you have positive. At least as fast as 1 by 8. Now, why did I want to know this? I want to know this because of this equation. Because of the equation here. Which is 3 by 8 squared into A dot squared plus K is equal to 8 by K epsilon. Okay? As A increases, so that's for G squared, epsilon A squared decreases. Because epsilon decreases at least as fast as 1 by 8. Okay? So So the right hand side here decreases. Now, what does that mean for Eidos? Let's look at the three possible cases. The first case is that k is equal to 1. Okay? At some point, the right hand side hits 3k, at which point a dot is 0. So, the expansion of the universe stops. And then the universe turns back, a dot. Okay? And then the universe turns back and comes back and collapses. Okay? So, independent of all details, if k is positive, independent of all details, if k is positive and the pressure is also positive, so that epsilon plus 3p is also positive, it is a generically true thing that the universe will expand, go to maximum size, stop, and come back, collapse. So k positive, along with the assumption that the pressure is positive, always gives rise to the universe that is. Okay? What about k negative? What about k negative? Along with the same assumption, the pressure. Right. This, as this decreases, as it decreases, a dot, so this thing goes to 0, a dot squared goes to a fixed constant value. The value that cancels is k. A dot squared is minus 1. And a dot squared is 1. So that it cancels minus 1. Okay? So in this case, the expansion of the history of the universe is this. Expansion current. Under the assumption that the pressure is not negative. Never goes negative. What about where k is equal to 0? In this case, as this goes to 0, a dot goes to 0. But never reaches. So it's very similar to the three kinds of orbits in a 1/r potential. K positive is like the elliptic orbit. And, you throw chalk up and if this was the center of the earth, it would just oscillate. Yeah. Okay. K equals 0 is very much like hyperbolic orbit. Just with escape velocity, just makes it elliptic. K negative is like a hyperbolic, not hyperbolic, sorry, parabolic. K negative is like a hyperbolic. It makes it infinity with some velocity. Okay, so this is a little like that. I mean, it's just an analogy. There's no particle or whatever. It's a little like it. Okay. All of this analysis, however, has been made under the assumption that the pressure is positive. Okay? And how if the pressure went negative on the other hand, you could well have acceleration rather than deceleration here because epsilon plus 3 being good. And all this analysis could completely change. Okay, this right hand side here would become positive. A needn't fall so fast. The analysis I made here that this goes to 0 as A becomes large need not be true. And this can completely change.
Pressure is negative, and in addition, there is a gravity. So, what will explain the acceleration?
Yeah, what explains the acceleration? That's a good question. Question. It would have made more sense if the sign of P had been first. I would miss double z. This had bothered me when I was looking at it. Let me just check against my work that I've got a site of rewriting.
Yeah, it's universal distribution.
Let's see, if we take the equation B is equal to 0, then
the
slightly singular thermodynamics. You know, you can think of it like maybe it's best to think of it as the limit of P is equal to epsilon to the alpha, and the limit alpha goes to 0. Okay? In that case, let's try that. Suppose you have a relation of sort of P is equal to epsilon to the power of alpha. In that case, thermodynamics, where you would associate a particular temperature with a particular energy density. Just like the usual formulas. Okay? And you could ask what temperature to associate with this. It's something you I won't try to work it out here. We could easily... Here, it's a well-defined question. Okay? And then we could take the alpha goes to zero limit. What is the plausible answer? Either the temperature is not defined. You know, but the actual dust system we're looking at, in its local rest frame, has no random motion. So I would suspect that if there's a well-defined temperature, it's effectively zero in this situation. Either this equation of state is so singular, or the temperature is in this particular case.
Excuse.
Yes.
So, in the limit of alpha going to 0, P would go to
0
then.
What?
0 would epsilon raised to alpha, right?
Yeah. Oh. Thank you. Sorry. What I meant was, P is equal to alpha to alpha. Thank you. Yeah. So, in this situation, we could quite easily actually work this out. But I'm gonna try it. Okay, great. Okay, so now so we've got epsilon is equal to alpha by AQ. Okay, this is another alpha. By the way, we can give alpha an interpretation along the lines that Hamish was suggesting, because the total rest mass of the system, total number of galaxies, okay, is as you suggested, is a cube into 2 pi squared qx. So this is the total number of galaxies times their rest mass. So let's call that a quantity, whatever it is, n. Total rest mass of our universe. Okay? So then in this situation, what do we have? We have epsilon is equal to, so this constant alpha is m by 2 pi squared. That 2 pi squared is just the volume of a unit 3 square. Have we got that wrong? Is it pi
cube?
No, that's just 2 square. This is a 3 dimensional sphere. We can work this out, but I think it's too much. Again, epsilon is equal to m. Yeah. So, giving an interpretation to what that constant is, it's this one. Okay. Now, let's plug this relationship into this quantity. Okay. So we have integral dA over A square root 8 pi g by 3 into epsilon, which is m by 2 pi squared times a cube. That was an a square, so that's 1 by a. Okay, minus k.
This can be taken as the mass corresponding to the total energy of the galaxy.
Total rest energy.
you know, the total energy of the galaxies.
Their rotation.
Yeah, it's the total rest energy associated with each galaxy. It's true. All the energy associated within a galaxy, that gives rise to some rest energy. But the energy of that collection, that I don't know how to define. Yes. Okay. Now, let's look at this in cases. Suppose k is equal to 1. Okay? So suppose k is equal to 1, what do we get? We get, and let's call this whole thing something positive. So let's call the whole thing enormous. Okay? So let's get a by so whatever it is, right? 4 by 3 by g m is equal to enormous. Okay, so the k is equal to, so okay, in general, this is dA by a naught square let's call it a naught square, see, maybe I want to call it a naught squared by a minus k is equal to dt. Is equal to d. Now, do this integral, this is, you know, every time you see a square root of 1 minus, positive minus something, you make a trigonometric substitution. Okay, so let's make the substitution, Okay, now let's, suppose k is equal to 1, then we make the substitution, a is equal to a naught squared in a sine squared. And it turns out to be convenient to make theta by 2, right? Okay? So now let's see how this integral goes. So we have dA is equal to a naught squared. The 2 goes because sine theta by 2 cos theta by 2. A itself is a naught sine theta by 2. A squared with this, right? Sorry. A was this thing square. So we got that right. dA was equal to a naught squared sine theta by 2 cos theta by 2. From here we write this as a, and then this becomes square root a. Right? So square root a is a naught sine theta by 2, and then this quantity here is a naught cos theta. So this whole thing here is the trigonometric guys vanish, which is why we made the substitution. A naughts vanish. Okay. So we have d eta is simply equal to d theta. Okay. So eta is theta up to some additive constant. Theta. But what was theta in terms of a? Theta was a was equal to a naught squared into minus cos theta. tells us that A is equal to A naught squared, which is this business, or we drop it out, whatever it was, right? So 4 by 3 pi gm by an additional 2, so not 2 by 3, g by 3, 3 pi m into 1 minus cos theta. Because theta is theta. Okay. This gives us A as a function of E. And at eta equals 0, we've chosen the 0 correctly, so at eta equals 0, A is 0, and eta equals 2 pi, A is 0 again. So as eta runs from 0 to pi, the universe expands to its maximum. And then from pi to 2 pi, it shrinks back again. Okay, so this illustrates this general analysis that we had that I previously discussed. Okay, one more quick thing. Let's also determine the relationship between eta and t in this analysis. Okay, so we have d eta by dt, which was this, is equal to 1 by eta. But 1 by A is equal to 2G M by 3 pi 1 minus cos theta. Okay? Which implies that T is equal to integral of this. So T into 2g m by t by t is equal to eta, and then the integral of cos eta is sub minus sine eta. Got it wrong? This was okay. Et 1 minus cos t.
T by t by t by t.
Oh,
I
got it. This side of wrong. Yeah, thank you. We know how A depends on eta. It's got this nice simple dependence. So let's plot both A and T as function. Okay? So as eta goes from 0 to 2 pi, T has a path that is just constantly increasing. But a path that's in space. Okay? So how the T clock runs changes. Okay, but let's plot these things. First, what was A? A looked like this. On the other hand, B looks like it's just constantly increasing. I'm not plotting this. Okay, it starts off with zero slope. Probably accelerates a lot of the difference. Probably ends up with zero. Okay? These two relations allow you parametrically to determine, I mean, A is a parametric determination of A as a function of T. So it would be, you know, messy if you tried to actually determine it exactly. This is one advantage of the eta coordinates, by the way. It's often easier to solve the equations explicitly in eta and then re-express in terms of that. Okay? Okay. Now, one or two other quick comments about. Okay, maybe I do the k negative case first. and then we'll have one of the three functions. Okay, the k negative k's can be done exactly in this similar way. I'll just write out the result. Something I should do is check I got my 2gm by 3 pi to right. Absolutely. Okay, so 2gm by 3 pi, this is quite amazing. Okay, so let me just comment on the k negative case. In that case, it turns out that this relation goes to 2gm by 3 pi into cos h eta minus 1. Okay? And this goes to in the actual universe, as far as we understand it today, it looks like stress energy is a combination of three kinds of matter. Okay. Of dust, which is the cold matter, including dark matter as well as visible matter. Radiation, which is a negligible fraction of what's going on today, but it was a very important part of the universe in the early part of the universe, like photon radiation. And it looks like a cosmological constant. Okay? So that's why I wanted to take you through the analysis separately of dust, radiation, and the cosmological constant before trying to put all these three together into one universe. Okay? So now we want to discuss the case of radiation.
So when you put these things together, the exchange between them also has to be
taken. The exchange between them has to be taken into account. Yes. However, you see, the cosmological constant doesn't exchange with anything. It's just constant. So it's the exchange between matter and radiation. Now, matter and radiation decouple. Once matter, early epoch in the age of the universe, up to a few hundred thousand years, the universe was ionized. So the matter was ions of, you know, ionized hydrogen, electrons and protons running around, and then the matter and the radiation were interacting in a very immediate and important way. But after matter re-unionized, you know, recombined, then the matter is essentially neutral. And the matter and the radiation have formed two non-interacting fluids thereafter. So it's true that during the era where things were ionized, you have to work harder. But after recombination, these were essentially two non-interacting fluids. Of course, the cosmological constant always is non-interacting. Well, at the if it's really a constant, if it's just a lambda term in the Einstein equations, it does not interact with anything. One can't be sure that it really is a constant. Yes, one can't be sure.
So mathematically, you cannot also lambda as a function.
Well, you know, the question is whether, you know, what lambdas, you need to give it dynamics there.
But I'm asking, does any sort of dynamics come from GRX?
No. You see, in the Lagrangian of general relativity, if lambda were anything but a constant, it would not break if you have diffeomorphism in the lens. So the only way for lambda not to be a constant would be for it.